Mushroom Quest round 2. Here we are in another cattle pasture, which you can tell evidenced by the paddies. There is more tree cover at this particular pasture, which might result in more or just different types of fungus. Since I live in Missouri, the two types of mushrooms that we're basically after is one that typically grows on trees, or rotting wood rather, has an orange coloration, an orange spore print, has an actual stalk, and typically grows in clusters. Its nickname is Big Laughing Jim, because it typically makes people goofy. The other is a mushroom that's more typically found in open grassy areas. The first one is a Gymnopilis, the second one is a Panaeolus. The Panaeolus is found in open grassy areas more often. It is more difficult to recognize. At first glance, it probably looks like a little brown mushroom, which, if you're familiar with mushroom hunting at all, little brown mushrooms are a pain and typically not worth bothering with. Most people just ignore little brown mushrooms, which is any mushroom that looks small, kind of like a small toadstool, nondescript, and brown at first glance. But Panaeolus underneath the cap is much darker than most little brown mushrooms. So hopefully that'll help us recognize it if we find some. I can see the first couple of mushrooms we found. They don't look like what we're looking for, unfortunately. What did you come off of? A crow, perhaps? I'm not familiar with crow feathers well enough to say, but I don't recognize what it came off of. But of course, if it wasn't a hawk or a turkey, I genuinely probably wouldn't recognize it. One of the hardest parts for me personally when mushroom hunting is realizing that you're not going to see a fair portion of the mushrooms at all. You just have to assume they're there, but you're going to miss them. Because nobody has Legolas's eyes. This awesome tree that you see before you is an Osage orange. They have some of the most amazing and interesting wood in the world for making things out of wood. But they also came with the cruel trick of nature that they tend to twist as they grow. So the pieces of wood you get from Osage orange trees are typically twisted instead of having a nice straight grain. A large amount of wood ear fungus there. So we found our second mushroom. Technically, I guess this would be our third. It's far too light colored to be Peniolus. The upside to hunting for a big laughing gem mushroom cluster is that they're probably going to be easier to spot than Peniolus mushrooms, which are much smaller, typically coming off of dirt, straight off of the dirt in a grassy area, whereas big laughing gems will probably be growing off of wood and are a much larger mushroom on average. So hopefully they'll be easier for us to spot. And of course we'd get more weight in actual mushroom on average. So hopefully we get lucky. And I say lucky because mushroom hunting is much more luck or even art than science. Which is why you can't go to your local grocer and buy just any mushroom you want. Many types of fungus have not been domesticated the way, for example, that we can just go to any store. I mean, even Walmart carries all the most popular types of seeds. You can go there and you can buy corn, sweet corn, green beans, peas. You can buy a huge range of flowers for plants that are known popularly as decorative plants or plants that are popular with pollinators. You can go to a store like Walmart or Lowe's in their garden section and buy whole trees that are grown by the millions across the world every year. What you can't just stumble into Walmart and buy is a kit for growing morel mushrooms, for example. And morels, of course, aren't the only one. They're on a long list of types of fungus that are difficult to grow, especially ones that seem to share a symbiotic relationship with some part of their environment. This is interesting. You can see feathers buried slightly right here, and then others, parts of the bird's body still. That's actually the skull, I think, and the beak. So clearly something killed a bird here and buried part of it. We have company. Check them out. They're just checking me out. They might not look intimidating on video. One second. They might not look intimidating on video, but cows are intimidating animals in person, in real life, up close, simply because they're huge. I don't know if you can tell. They're hesitant of me. They're not terrified or anything. They're more curious. I don't know if you can tell, but in real life, these animals weigh hundreds, if not thousands, of pounds. It is not a problem for a cow to be over 1,000 pounds in weight. These animals are huge. And, of course, there are very few things that are that large that aren't dangerous. What we're looking at here, I thought at first glance was a type of puffball, but it isn't. Something else. A hard white fungus, but not a puffball. Oh, quit it. They're acting skittish just because I stood up quickly. I don't recognize this. Scat from something, poop from something, but I don't recognize it. I think it could be a small calf. But none of them look quite young enough for something that small. But who knows? I could be completely way off. You can see this row of trees I've been following is part of something I've mentioned in other videos. It's a old fence line. So early farmers in Missouri would plant fences of trees, especially the Osage orange tree. The Osage orange tree, as I mentioned, it twists a lot, but it's also fairly flexible when it's young, younger branches. So you can easily train it across a fence. So you could actually just take... I've read that this was actually done, that farmers would take Osage orange fruit, which the fruit is a large green ball, about the size of a softball on average, and it's hard. Yeah, here we go. Here's one on the ground. This one on the ground is only about the size of a baseball. So they would take these. This one's been tore open a little bit by a squirrel. Squirrels eat the seeds out of these. So if you do ever come across some of these green balls, some of them are all tore up to bits. That's evidence of squirrels getting after the seeds inside. The rest of it isn't palatable to anything. Nothing really eats them. But here's an example of what I was talking about with training the branches. You can see that this piece of the Osage orange tree is very flexible. So anyway, the farmers would take these Osage orange balls, filled with the Osage orange seeds, of course, toss them into a bucket of some sort, mash them all up into a slurry, and even let it overwinter, just let it freeze solid. And then when spring gets there and it thaws, this bucket thaws out, they take this big barrel, put it on a tractor or whatever, move it however they can, and they dump it along their fence row, where they have a metal fence. And 10 years later, they have a fence made out of Osage orange trees. It's that simple. And if you actually work the Osage orange trees regularly, you can easily branch these young growths together. When the tree is young, you can bend it over to the ground, and then its branches will grow almost straight up. It's an awesome tree for a type of building with nature method. Also, you can see that some of them have these noticeable thorns. I forget if it's the males or the female of the tree, or if it's both, but I think it's only the male or the females of the Osage orange trees that develop thorns. But yeah, here's an interesting fungus going on here on the side of the tree, but you can see I can actually bend this fairly easily, this whole thick branch coming off from down here. And if I were to take and just cut this tree down in half, right at like 3 feet up from the trunk, it would spring up next year with mostly growth like that, these thin branches. So you can easily continue to have a short fence if you just keep trimming the tree. You can do the same thing sort of with a mulberry tree, for example. Most of the times, if you try to chop down a mulberry tree, next year you're just going to get a stump with a bunch of thin mulberry branches growing out of it. You're not going to actually kill the tree. And you can do that to make a sort of mulberry bush tree out of a stump kind of thing. This is interesting. A plant growing out of a knot in a tree. Those are always cool. Nothing I could find. Certain mushrooms, like I mentioned, have a symbiotic relationship with other plants, or even with other animals. For like example, how typically if you're going to find Panaeolus mushrooms, it's going to be in an area where a large herbivore has defecated. Somewhere that cattle or horses crap regularly, basically. And then there are other mushrooms that, if you want to find those, you need to go somewhere that something else happens or exists. And that's a part of the relationship that mushroom has with some other factor in the environment. Which is why you can't just take the spores, which spores for fungus are basically like... Spore is to fungus like seed is to plant, basically. I don't want to oversimplify it, but basically it's kind of like that. But because of these symbiotic relationships, you can't just take the seeds like you would find inside of this Osage orange ball, this brain fruit, as I like to call it growing up. Brain because of that sort of... appearance. This is another old fence row. You can see this one here is a younger Osage orange tree, but this one has some significant age to it. This is a large tree. I would bet you anything this tree here, this cluster that's tripled out, this is over 50 years old. Something in the sky above me making that loud noise, if you can hear that. Here's another one. Obviously, it was part of the same fence row, planted sometime near the same, near that one, I would estimate. And again, this is a very old tree, easily twice, three times my age. And you can see how Osage orange trees get this awesome sort of bark pattern when they're older. You can see this cool weave that almost looks like you would have to design it like this. I mean, there are people that pay a lot of money for this carved into wood. But of course, the Osage orange tree is enough of an artist that just does it on its own. Without even trying. I shouldn't say that. Who knows how hard that tree tries? What is that? I see a color of something over here. It's just a leaf. Unfortunately, just a leaf. There's something playing around in there. Let's investigate. Well. That didn't spook it, whatever it is. I'm not sticking to the trees just because of the chance of running into a big laughing gem on a piece of rotting wood. I'm sticking to the trees. That's interesting. What's going on here? These ants are clearly devouring this fungus of some sort. Some kind of white mold type fungus. And they are apparently enjoying it. Actually, I'm not sure if they are eating it. It almost looks... I can't tell if they're eating it or if their colony was under where this fungus grew, and maybe the fungus has a symbiotic relationship with the ants. There are ants that actually sort of farm fungus. But I'm watching them remove bits of it, or bits of dirt, and I mean, I can't tell which. So I'm not sure if they're getting rid of the fungus, and it grew on top of their colony, and they're angry at it, or if... I don't know, see, there appears to be a sort of trail of the fungus. Maybe the ants did sort of track around the fungus, but that doesn't answer the question whether they use it or not. Of course, I could look it up at home, but at some point in time, somewhere on Earth, somebody has probably already done the research of observing these ants every single day in, day out, and watching how they coexist with this fungus, how they relate to it, and what they do when confronted with it, when it's around. I like to stress how much of learning is observation of the natural world. A lot of people think of learning as getting nature to succumb, bending nature and tricking nature, trying to, you know, come up with a synthetic leaf in the sense that, like, trying to develop a better solar panel, something that converts energy, light to energy, better than your average tree leaf. I don't see it that way. I see it as we learn the idea of converting light to energy from observing nature. When we see plants do this, it gives us the idea to try it ourselves. So I know, obviously, there aren't going to be any mushrooms in this pond. But who knows, maybe we'll see something interesting. Obviously, we've been talking about mushroom hunting this whole time, but no part of talking about mushroom hunting changes the fact that we are in an old cattle pasture. As evidenced by the trees, this is a cattle pasture that, or at least an area where there has been a cattle pasture for an extended period of time, and we found a puffball. It's not a giant puffball, it's a type of forest puffball. It's this tough little brown mushroom here. And if you feel it, it has almost like a leathery texture. Here's an old one, I believe. Yeah, here's an old one. And what you'll see is that there's this, what looks like mud now, but what this actually was before, this sort of powdery stuff, this is all spores. It feels like a fine chalk when you actually rub it in your fingers, and it's because the spores are so incredibly tiny. Spores are incredibly tiny. Many people use microscopes to identify spores, if you see some kind of plant seed, typically most people can just hold it in their hand and look right at it. You cannot do that with mushroom spores. Not unless you're some kind of amazing expert identifying them by traits other than their shape, since they're pretty much all too small to identify that way. It appears we have another one over here. And here. Yeah, there's definitely a little colony of puffballs here. And something has been working away on this log. There's probably an incredible, incredible ant colony inside of here. Well, and built into the actual ground below as well. I can see some evidence of an ant colony. Back to this, though. I noticed when looking at that puffball, there are two small mushrooms coming up here. Not sure what they are. But they are growing almost directly out of what you can tell is an old cow paddy. Which would be a good sign, but I'm fairly certain, even at this age, as young as they are, even though I don't know what they are, I know that they aren't Panaeolus cinctalis. But I can't be positive on that. I definitely can't be positive on it. I can see what looks like... Not even sure what that is. Chunk of wood with some fungus on it. Damn it, mushrooms. Cut me some slack already. Be quiet, cows. Nobody asked you. Did you hear that frog?
Meep!
Well, as nice as the break in the shade has been, I think we should circle the pond. Since most bodies of water, as you can see here, there's a slope. You can see an old house on the hill. I'm fairly certain that it's still vacant. Nobody lived there a year ago. It's been abandoned for some time. The owner moved out of state and hasn't sold it yet. But he does have family members who mow it regularly. Maybe he just has the price set too high or whatever. That's neither here nor there. Point is, you can see the slope up the hill, from the hill, coming down. And that means that a lot of water comes this way. So we can circle the pond and likely we're on a route that stays extra moist. And everybody knows mushrooms love moisture. We did just get rain yesterday, but it's summer in Missouri, so it doesn't really take very long for things to heat up and dry out. You can see these large, sort of spade-shaped leaves right here. If I remember right, that's wapato or water potato. It's a wild edible that you can harvest. And the flowers look amazing when they're in bloom. You can kind of see some of them now. If, for example, this was a starving sort of situation, if the world ended, this would be an awesome place to find because of the population of these wapato potatoes, these water potatoes. Doesn't look like this route around the pond is going to have any mushrooms. Looks like it gets a little too much sun, even if it does get extra moisture. Looks like we need to find somewhere with some shade, even if it's just dense grass. And if it doesn't look like we're finding much after a little while in the grass, I vote, even though there is a fence separating the cattle from the woods, I vote we move into the woods, which will probably remove our odds of finding any Peniolus, but increase the odds of us finding a Gymnopolis, a big laughing gym type mushroom. Wow, that was a rather large frog. Quite a splash. I'm guessing no fish population in this pond. Probably just a frog and turtle type pond. Since usually these cattle ponds don't have a good fish population since they're kept so shallow and they're so heavily frequented by the cattle. Keeping them shallow makes it safer for the cattle. But of course it means there's no deeper water for the fish. This area that I'm walking through now, this sort of low to the ground clover almost looks like a lawn area. From what I've read and seen, a honeybee, that's a good sign. Well, good sign for the earth, not the mushrooms. But back to what I've seen and read, is suggestive that this is pretty ideal habitat, a cattle pasture in an area that is eaten down this low to the ground, so much so that it almost looks like a mowed lawn. Not sure if the camera does it justice, but it is partly cloudy and about 90 degrees out. Something else concerns me. I think it might have to do with the size of the pasture. Maybe the fecal matter, the manure doesn't come down often enough in the open pasture areas like this for the fungus to establish a population, because I often note in large pastures, cow pastures like this, that there is almost no population whatsoever of giant puffball mushrooms. But I have a fair amount of experience working and living near a much smaller pasture with just a couple of equines, a horse and a donkey, on it. And it exhibits a fair population of puffball mushrooms, giant puffball mushrooms, which can get the size of basketballs and are edible, so they're awesome. But the fact that it's difficult to ever look out over a cattle pasture, at least in my parts of Missouri, and see these large white puffballs at a distance just when driving by, which should be a common thing. It's not even that rare to drive by people's yards and see certain mushrooms coming up, especially if that person fertilizes their lawn and all. But catching sight of something like Panaeolus mushrooms, they're much too small to catch from the road. You pretty much have to get in there and get your feet on the ground in the area where you think they might grow. Now this is obviously where the farmer has shoved up a bunch of trees into a pile, a bunch of old trees that he tore down. Almost looks like some trees that he burnt a little bit and then shoved it into a pile. This might be an ideal spot for Gymnopolis Big Laughing Gym mushrooms. And as you can see, fresh cow manure, so the cattle have no problem hanging out over here. You can see that it's packed down from their constant walking. No doubt they come here for the shade, obviously. Cluster of Osage orange trees. Many times when a cattle pasture has a random cluster like this, where there is standing trees, it usually means there was something in the field that the farmer couldn't move with his tractor, like a well or a large concrete foundation from an older home. But I don't see any of that here. So he might have left this cluster because he hunts from nearby, leaves it as almost a bait for deer. You leave a cluster, a circle of trees in the middle of a pasture, and when a deer moves from the edge of the pasture to the cluster of trees, the deer is exposed. It has to move across the actual pasture to reach that island of trees of cover in the center. Which it does, you know, out of curiosity, and because that cluster in the center is green, there are trees, there are plants to nibble on. Damn. Doesn't appear to be any mushrooms under here. But I suppose it shouldn't come as much of a surprise since these are very old trees. So let's cut... I wanted to say footloose so bad. Let's cut straight across. See if we spot anything on the way. If not, then as soon as the sun comes back out, let's duck into the actual wooded area. You know, just to save my fragile, pale skin. I have noticed this plant here, which I don't mind tearing some off to show you, because as far as memory serves, it's overabundant and invasive. I love those little guys. It's overabundant and invasive. You can actually see it here. There is too much of it, but I have noticed what a large portion of it around some of the puffball mushrooms I have discovered in the past. So there might be something to do with it and puffballs. So I'm gonna stay as close as I can to it. Just kind of try to look around. Not that we're after the puffball mushroom, but trust me, if you've ever sliced open a large puffball mushroom and fried it up, sauteed it in butter, and eaten it, you would understand. What is that? Is that a cluster of flowers or something else? Looks strange from here. Do you see it? Something white. Could be. It looks like a mushroom. Wow, it's a rather large mushroom cluster. Unfortunately, I'm pretty certain that these are a type of inedible, possibly poisonous lepiotas. What I'll do is take one on our way back as a sample, and I'll take a spore print. But I'm pretty certain you can see it has a ring on the stalk. It's a large, white, flat-topped almost mushroom. Light-colored gills. Most of those are a type of Lepiota, L-E-P-I-O-T-A. I'm not 100% if it's Lepiota, Lepiota. Not 100% on the pronunciation because I've only read it. I've never heard it spoken, which is how I end up screwing up a lot of pronunciations. But most of them are a tricky enough identification that fans of edible mushrooms just avoid them altogether. You can see, though, how some mushrooms get easily large enough to catch sight of from the road if you aren't at an incline from the other side of the hill where they grew on. But if those were within 15-20 feet of the fence there instead of right over there, you could spot those as you drove by this cattle pasture. If they were in an area eaten down a little bit further by the cattle, you could probably see them from much further away. But I keep not seeing that happen with giant puffballs. So it concerns me because I enjoy eating them and I can't find them. Another thing worth mentioning, if you're a fan, is that mushrooms often grow in the same spot each year. You consider the mushroom above ground almost like the fruit of a tree. That's a comparison that many people use. And what I mean by that is that the mushroom, the mushroom isn't the organism. The organism itself is mostly a network under the ground called a mycelium. M-Y-C-E-L-I-U-M. This underground network, it could be compared to could be compared to a tree and how it fruits. You eat the apple, but the apple is not the tree itself, and there will be apples next year coming off of that same tree. Well, if you think of the mycelium under the ground like a tree, then what you get is basically that next year the mushrooms will grow off of the tree again. But the tree is underground. So instead of having an easy landmark of a large lumbering wooden giant, you have to try to mark it in some other way. But you don't want to disturb the soil too much, since that is where the mycelium lives. Right now I'm just looking for a good spot to cross. Somewhere that, at a glance, looks interesting. Plus, you can see I'm kind of following a bit of an animal trail. Not something too well trafficked. Clearly the cattle don't love this side a lot. But it's common for animals, even in a large pasture like this, to march around their exterior a little bit, the way they sort of checking the fence for weaknesses. And even if they find like just a small exit, your average curious horse or cow, go ahead, just wander right through, start exploring. I see some old small building right there. Almost looks like a old chicken coop. Let's check it out. When stepping through barbed wire fences as a team, you want somebody else to sort of step on one layer, like this, in between the barbs, and pick up on the other layer. And that makes a large gap for you to step through. When you do it solo, it's a pain. You just have to be really careful. Unless you don't care about the clothes you're wearing, in which case, you don't have to be careful. Just go ahead and try to get through there any way you can. You'll get scratched up a little bit and probably tear up your clothes a little bit, but you'll get through. I lost track of time, so this might run over an hour. I don't know. We'll see. Something clearly sleeps under there regularly. Seems like a pretty nice little house for something. What have we got here? Just a plastic tub. Just a plastic tub. For no apparent reason. Wouldn't be too bad of a find in an apocalyptic scenario, right? This does not appear to me as caused by water. I think it could be. It could just be the runoff from the tin roof right there causes the plants here to lay down. Yeah, I'm gonna go with that. Because it's too large of an area to be a bedding area. Too large. Animals that bed down in an area repeatedly will cause the grass to lay down like that. But I think that's too extreme of an example, and there's that tin roof nearby, which would catch all of the water hitting it and direct it in one spot. So I'm gonna go with that's caused by water running off. It's important to figure out what causes things like that, since not that all superstitions and legends and myths are mistakes, such as saying like, oh, well, fairies must put mushrooms in a circle. That doesn't have to be at its core a mistake for it also to be important to identify when water runs off like that, so that people don't make an assumption that it's caused by something else. Not that I'm certain that it is the water running off that causes that, just that it is important to try to ascertain causes. Well, you can see right here, that someone nearby, often enough, hunts from right here. One thing I could totally see happening if... Now I'm not trusting this thing. If there was a shortage, well, let's just say, to sum it up, an apocalyptic scenario, I could see deer stands being valuable. I mean, it's like a tower you can sit on that you can attach to any tree. And I could totally see them being attached, conveniently, to telephone poles. This one goes about 20 feet up. For people that don't know what a deer stand is, and don't want to have to jump out and Google it, if you don't live anywhere near people where people deer hunt, a deer stand, tree stand, deer stand, is literally just a ladder up a tree. Some people even just nail 2x4s to the tree to use as a ladder. Some people buy a metal ladder like this and strap it to the tree with a couple supports. You get it up to the top of the tree here, strap it on. It's all attached, it's nice, it's safe, it's sturdy. And then you just sit up here with your gun. Early morning during deer season. Usually with a plot of some kind of basically bait, to be honest. And you can see right beside me here, there is a plot of corn right there. Just thrown in, not really like well kept and not sprayed or anything. You can see all the grass growing in it, so all the other plants and weeds growing in it. So it's not taken care of in any way, left natural really. Just throw a bunch of corn out there, it grows, and that's going to be a place that deer recognize is a good spot to come get some food regularly. And that means that when you do pick the right morning to come out here and just sit a few mornings in a row, eventually you're going to see a deer wander in there to get some corn. And that sets you up for an easy shot when it happens. And of course, you're more likely to get it because deers don't look up as much as they look straight forward, left, right, and behind themselves. They're actually really good at that. If you make almost any noise, and a deer is around, it probably hears you. Deer are very sharp. People sitting in deer stands sit for a reason. It allows you to be a little bit more quiet than standing. You move around less. And it's important not to move around when you're trying to be dead silent. And dead silent is important because, like I said, deer are very sharp. We've seen a couple in the videos on the channel here, but those were young and inexperienced. They're the kinds, get out of the tree, stop it, damn it, tree. The kind that get picked off early in life. So now we need to pick a spot to just head into the woods here. Guess this one looks as good as any. I had to pick this spot that has raspberry bush. Hunting for mushrooms in a more wild area like this presents an even larger challenge, since the undergrowth is much more rampant, much more out of control. It's just some kind of small fly buzzing. I caution you guys watching this. I don't usually go out of my way to tell you guys, like, oh, don't do this, don't do that. Usually I reserve that sort of cliche disclaimer for something I worry might receive a YouTube complaint, like me taking my own blood for the homunculus thing, or cutting myself or something that could be perceived as dangerous or harmful. But in this case, I want to go ahead and point out, if you hear a buzzing sound while you're out hiking in an area you're not familiar with especially, just as quickly as you can, try to assess which direction it's coming from and move away. I can't stress it enough. If you're going to die in the woods, it's probably going to be bees. I know some of you right now are saying, like, yeah, but I live somewhere that has really dangerous animals, like bears, large cats, like a mountain lion. I understand. Well, come on, spiders. Bah. I have to break your web, I'm sorry. I understand if you live somewhere more dangerous than Northwest Missouri, but trust me when I say you don't live somewhere more dangerous than right beside a beehive. If you hear buzzing, stop for a moment, try to assess it as quickly as possible, and get away from the buzzing, because bees are serious business. Look what we found. Cicada shell. We need to get ourselves into some more densely clustered trees and less undergrowth. We're not going to find dead trees for a big laughing Jim to be growing on over here in all of this short stuff. Really? Some kind of grapevine in front of me that I got snagged on, and is literally tougher than what my body weight will break. Ugh. Not that I'm a big guy. 150 pounds. 160. Something in between there. I could stand to drop a couple pounds. I'm a little out of shape. I still have an average, about a 9-minute mile, but a little out of shape. Of course, it's easy to skip generic, boring run along the highway type cardio and exercise when you could be doing something like this, where it's so much more interesting because it represents that element of what you could possibly run into. I see some dense trees straight that way, but the trees also look much more denser to the left of us. Let's just try to head straight across quickly. See if the route is easier. All right, that's better. I'm sure you can tell right away that the camera looks a little different since the light of the sun is pretty much gone. And we're looking at a pretty large pile of dead old wood. That's a good sign. It's not a good sign that there's a bunch of old, that's a bedspring, and other metal from, this is an old stove. Something else, and something else. So I'm gonna go ahead and estimate from the metal there that we're not gonna find anything, since that area is way too old. The wood is long, long, long beyond the age of developing a good mushroom. And holy shit! What have we discovered here? There's an old wood, an old stove. I see some bricks laying around on the ground here. Like this one. Bricks. This old glass jar. Some metal and tin metal. And what have we got over here? What have we got? Well, this is clearly a trail of some sort made by a human. This is not cut by animals. It's too low in the vegetation department. What we've got here, in case you don't recognize this, was a windmill at one point in time that powered that, which was a pump. I can throw the brick. Keep in mind, that's a good glass bottle for the apocalypse. Talking a lot about the apocalypse this video. And this is the frame above what was the well. I mean, that metal pipe, no doubt, went to the well as well. This is goofy. I'm positive that just this well structure... I mean, I'm sure... Mushroom! Damn. Nah. It's nothing we're looking for, and it's pretty old, too. I'm sure that many of you are familiar with the fact that antiques can be sold for large amounts of money. Something like this has a strong appeal to people that are into rustic things. I mean, it could even be... Not by me, but... I'm sure someone could restore it to a working fashion, working order. But to someone, it's not worth the effort. They just dozed up as much of this stuff as they could and then left it. Here's a piece of concrete. And it's old concrete, you can tell from the bits of large rock in it. Apparently this was pretty close to where the home was built. I would say somewhere close to those bricks. This, if you don't recognize what this is, these are actually the ladder, basically. This is your ladder to climb all the way up there to the top of the windmill to service the windmill. It works, it's sturdier than it looks. But while I am fairly certain I could climb to the top of this without it collapsing on me, my shoelace is untied. More brick, more metal, some mushrooms growing off of the tree there, some turkey tail just growing off of an old stick. Looks like this is part of a curve around trail someone developed. What is that? See that on the right side? Right there? That's somebody's trail camera. That pile of stuff there might have been some kind of bait of some sort for deer. But this is a trail camera. You attach these to trees, set them up in areas where you want to catch pictures of wildlife. They're mostly used, honestly, around these parts. You can see the tracks in the mud there. They're mostly used around these parts, for snapping pics of the deer in your area. You set up some bait, set up a camera. It gets you pictures of the deer in your area reliably, frequently. When the deer walk in front of it, a motion detector sensor picks up the deer and takes a picture. Hey, who do you think you are? Who do you think you are, huh? What are you doing? Come here, you. Who do you think you are? Get out of here. Go on. There you go. So which way, left or right? Oh, the cardinal has told us. I hope you guys caught videos, you know, view of that cardinal. Oh my gosh, that's so soft. That's unbelievably soft. Feels like a puppy dog's ears. I'm talking about that white fungus, by the way, not something else. I can see somebody just editing that clip right out of context. Trails are tempting. You can see plenty of effort put into cutting a trail through here. Trails often disturb the wood line, but sometimes that's a good thing. Sometimes the disturbed wood line leads to new growth. Ah, damn it, spiders. Come on, man. Got me right in the eye. Right in the eye, spider. More toads? Come on. So we're off the actual trail and we're on just an animal trail now. For those of you tuning in, Wild Wednesdays, this one seeming like more of a mushroom hunt. Of course, I'm looking out for mushrooms every time we do a Wild Wednesday video, really. But this one is more focused purpose, more focused effort. But the basic idea behind the Wild Wednesdays is to get outside into the wild. Outside into the wild. Perfect phrasing. And hope, while you're out here, that you run into something unusual, something rare, something that could be described as mythological, cryptozoological, legendary in that sense. Examples would be things like goblins, pixies, fairies, unicorns, trolls, elves, gnomes, etc. That's the hope. To go somewhere where there aren't very many people very frequently and try to find something rare. Run into it. You can see a sample of what I was talking about earlier, where if you cut an Osage orange stump, the Osage orange will grow off of that in these small branches that you can go ahead and tie to the ground and create a fence out of it. Not sure when or why that Osage orange tree there was cut down, but it was. Some kind of young pin mushrooms. I've looked these up before. They're a really beautiful sort of ice white color with dark stalks. Few more of them I can see around my feet. Well, I see two or three dead logs. Still fairly firm, but I don't see any mushrooms. I do hear, and I'm sure the camera's picking up, the buzzing of several mosquitoes that are bugging me. Wow. This was a large tree back in its day. It's been a long, long time since this fell. Damn. I thought this might be Pinaeolus, but it is not. Boy, these mosquitoes are getting dense. Well, I do see plenty of turkey tail. I think this large stump is a good stopping point for the first half of the video. The second half, I'll do similar things, but it'll be with the camera off. Camera off to entertain the possibility that what we're looking for here, these creatures, these mythological creatures, rare creatures, cryptids. I can hear an owl hooting. Entertains the possibility that they can somehow purposely keep themselves off camera, that they can only present themselves to a person without a video camera going. And we entertain this possibility simply because there isn't reliable video footage of most of these creatures, almost at all. So we have to entertain that they can't be caught on camera. And that's the reason for running the second half without the camera. So for the next hour, I'll be doing the same exact thing pretty much, but without the camera on. If I run into anything absolutely spectacular, I'll either recount it at the end of the video and you'll have to take my testimony, or if possible, if it seems at all possible, I will turn the camera on when I run into that strange event or interesting occasion. That's it. I'll see you guys in an hour. And if you guys like this sort of thing, Wild Wednesday, if you found anything in this video interesting, awesome, cool, that's great, I'm glad. Let me know in the comments below, and if you don't want to miss future ones like this, doing other things, not always mushroom hunting, but basically Wild Wednesday, out here in the woods, urbexing, that sort of thing. If you dig it, there'll be a subscribe button in one of the corners. Thanks.